This is the Python code needed to create and train a neural network that detects handwritten digits with over 90% accuracy. No worries, I'll explain and animate everything in detail, so you'll understand the code by the end of this video. A neural network consists of a bunch of neurons that are connected through weights. One column of neurons is also called a layer. There are three different types. The first type is called input layer and is used to represent the input values that are passed on to the neural network. The second type is called hidden layer. A hidden layer receives values from a preceding layer, does some magic, and passes its neuron values to the subsequent layer. A neural network can have 0 to, well, basically unlimited hidden layers. The third type is called output layer and is used to represent the output values. It is basically the same as a hidden layer, except that its neuron values are used as output and are not passed onto a subsequent layer. When each neuron in a layer is connected with each neuron in the next layer, as shown here, the layers are fully connected. In this example, the input layer is fully connected with the hidden layer, and the hidden layer is fully connected with the output layer. There are other ways to connect two layers, but fully connected layers are most used. Okay, and what exactly do neurons represent? Just numbers. In our case, the input neurons are represented by pixel values of an image, and the hidden and output neurons are calculated using the input values and weights. But more about that later. For now, just remember that a neuron is just a value. What are the weights then? Well, as the name suggests, just numbers that are randomly initialized. A good practice to do this is using a range of small random values with a median close to zero. For example, minus 0.5 to 0.5. To initialize the weights, we also need to know the number of neurons in each layer, which are 5, 4, and 3. Therefore, the weight matrix connecting the input layer with the hidden layer has a shape of 4 by 5, while the weight matrix connecting the hidden layer with the output layer has a shape of 3 by 4. Defining the matrix from the right layer to the left layer is not quite intuitive at first, but it is the recommended way and results in cleaner and faster computations later. So I'd recommend sticking to this order. There's one more thing to do when creating a neural network. Let me introduce the bias neuron. This is a special neuron that is always one and only has outgoing weights. Remember that the other neurons also have incoming weights. Initializing the bias weights is like initializing the weights for the other neurons, with the difference that the initial values for the weights are zero. This is because we want to start with an unbiased neural network. But why exactly do we need the bias? The idea behind it can be shown when looking at a graph. Think about a very simple neural network with only one neuron and no hidden layer. This network can only learn a linear function. While the normal weight determines the slope of the function, the bias weight allows the function to shift up and down. This means that the neural network is only able to accurately distinguish the circles from the crosses when it makes use of the bias neuron. Now that we know how a neural network is structured, we can take a closer look at the images used for training. The images itself are of size 28 by 28, which means they consist of 784 values. This means that our neural network is way too small, so for the animations we'll just use 5 instead of all 784 values. To train it on all values, we basically just need to increase the number of weights in the code. To later train the neural network, each image needs a so-called label that specifies which number the image represents. In this example, the label is 0. You're probably wondering where the images and labels are from and how many images we have for training. Well, classifying images has been a challenging problem a few decades ago. To figure out how good an algorithm is compared to other algorithms, Some researchers collected 60,000 handwritten images, converted them into 28 by 28 grayscale images, and paid some fellow humans to label them. They gave it the name MNIST database, which stands for Modified National Institute of Standards and Technology Database, and published it online, where it became wildly popular. Today, it can be thought of as the Hello World dataset for machine learning. To get the images and labels into our Python program, we need to execute this line of code. It fills the first variable with 60,000 images, each of which consisting of 784 values. Therefore, it has a shape of 60,000 by 784. The second variable is filled with the labels, which we expect to be of size 60,000 by 1. But if we were to execute this line, we'd see that the shape is 60,000 by 10. This is because as soon as we have a classification problem with more than two possible outputs, we need to represent the labels in a binary format, also called one-hot encoded. To illustrate this, let's assume we want to classify an image which has the label 3. Since we have 10 possible labels in general, we need 10 output neurons in our neural network, and if our neural network is trained perfectly, we'd expect all output neurons to be 0, except the fourth one, which should be 1. But because the untrained neural network just puts out some random values, we need to tell it what output we expected. So our 3 is transformed to this binary vector, which is then used to calculate the difference towards the output. But more about that later, just remember that the label is represented in a binary format. With this in place, we can now look at how to train the neural network. The training occurs inside two loops. The inner loop iterates through all image label pairs, while the outer loop specifies how often we iterate through all images. This means if the variable epochs is set to 3, we go through all images 3 times. So everything I explain while we're inside these loops occurs 3 times for each of the 60,000 images. If we take a look at the shape information for the variables img and l, we can see that both are vectors. This is a problem because we are doing matrix multiplications with the weight matrices later on, and the operation fails if one operand is a matrix and the other a vector. That's why we need to reshape both vectors with the following two lines. The first line changes the shape of the variable img from a vector of size 784 to a 784 by 1 matrix, while the second line changes the shape of the variable l from a vector of size 10 to a 10 by 1 matrix. This brings us to the first training step called forward propagation. It is used to transform the input values into output values. To show this on the small network, let's take 5 pixel values as input. The values are normalized into a range of 0 to 1, meaning that a white pixel has the value 1, a black pixel has the value 0, and a gray pixel is somewhere in between depending on its grayscale. To get the hidden layer values, we need to take the input values and the weight matrix that connects both layers, then multiply them through matrix multiplication and add the bias weights. Let's illustrate this in detail for the first hidden neuron. Each input value is multiplied with its weight connection that goes to the first hidden neuron. The resulting 5 values are then summed up. Last, the bias weight is added and voila, we have the hidden neuron value. Note that the bias neuron is not directly present in the implementation because 1 times the bias weight values equals the bias weight values. But it's more tangible to think that there is also a bias neuron as shown here. You might wonder why the variable is named h_pre. That's because we're not done with the hidden layer yet. The value in one of the hidden neurons could be extremely large compared to the values in the other hidden neurons. To prevent this, we want to normalize the values into a specific range like we did for the input values. This can be done by applying an activation function to it. A commonly used one is the sigmoid function. It is defined as follows, looks like this, and normalizes its input, which is h underscore pre in our case, into a range between 0 and 1. That's exactly what we want. We then repeat the same procedure to get the output values and therefore finish the first training step. The second step is to compare the output values with the label, which is 0. Please remember that we use a smaller network for the visualizations, meaning that the network shown here can only learn to differentiate between the numbers 0, 1 and 2. To compare the output values with the label, we need some sort of function again, this time called cost or error function. Like for the activation function, there are many possible functions. We'll stick with the most commonly used one, which is the mean squared error. It works by calculating the difference between each output and the corresponding label value, then squaring each difference, followed by summing the resulting values together and dividing it by the number of output neurons. The resulting value is our cost or error, depending on which word you prefer. The second code line checks whether our network classified the input correctly. For this, we check which neuron has the highest value. Here it is the first neuron, so our neural network classified the input as 0. Because this matches the label, we increase our counter by 1. If the label would have been 1 or 2, we would not increase the counter. Please note that this line is not important for the training itself, but we do it because we would like to know how many images are classified correctly after each epoch. Now that we have the error value, we need to know how strong each weight participated towards it and how we can adjust the weights to have a smaller error when we see the same inputs again. This is the most crucial and complicated part about training neural networks. The underlying algorithm is called backpropagation. You've probably already seen it mathematically written somewhere. If not, there you go. But please don't panic, rather look at the code. It's actually just 6 lines. Backpropagation works by propagating the error from the end back to the start. We start with our weights that connect the hidden layer with the output layer. In the first step, we need to calculate the delta for each neuron. Normally, we'd need the derivative of the cost function. But thanks to a few mathematical tricks that can be used for the mean squared error cost function, we can just write O minus L. So the delta for an output neuron is basically just the difference between its output and the label. So what's with the error value we calculated in the last step then? Well, we don't need it. But I still wanted to show it to you because it is required when having a different cost function. In the next step, the delta values are used in a matrix multiplication with the hidden layer outputs to get an update value for each weight connecting both layers. Since the update values just represent how to improve the weights with respect to the current input, we want to adjust the weights carefully. Therefore, we multiply them with a small learning rate. But why is there a minus in front of it? Well, I won't go into detail about it in this video, but you can think of the update values as values representing how to maximize the error for the input. So we need to negate them to have the opposite effect. Alright, so now we have updated the weights between the hidden and output layer except for the bias weights. The idea is basically the same with the difference that the bias neuron value is always 1. Since there's no need to multiply something with 1, we can just multiply the delta values with the learning rate and negate the result. If we look at the update for the weights connecting the input layer with the hidden layer, we can see that nearly everything looks the same except for the delta calculation. That's because this time we can't use some mathematical tricks to simplify the equation, so we need the derivative of the sigmoid function h, which is sigmoid times 1 minus sigmoid. So we can write it as h times 1 minus h. Then we need our updated weight matrix, transpose it, matrix multiply it with the delta values, and finally multiply that result with the derivative values. The resulting delta values show how strong each hidden neuron participated towards the error. Those values can then be used to calculate the update values for weights connecting the input with the hidden layer. And if we would have a few more hidden layers with the sigmoid activation function, we just have to repeat those steps over and over till all weights are updated. That's it! Now you know how to train a neural network from scratch. Let's run it and see what accuracy we can achieve. While it's running, I'd like to let you know that any additional information and corrections that might come up after publishing this video will be added to the description. So if there's anything you're wondering about, I've probably already added it in there. If not, feel free to ask in the comment section. Wow, over 93%! That's quite good. But there's one part left. What is it for? Well, using the neural network in action, of course. Let me quickly go through what's happening here. First, we expect an input between 0 and 59,999, which is used to choose one of our 60,000 images. We then extract the specified image and add it to a plot object. Next, we do the forward propagation step to get our output values and set the title of the plot to the number of the strongest activated neuron. Then we show the plot and can see that the neural network correctly identified the 3. So we scroll down, hit the subscribe button and ignore the notification bell, which is a huge mistake because then we cannot be the dude writing first or second in the comment section. The code explained here will be available for everyone. Link in the description. The video is animated using Python. A second video about how I created this video, as well as the Python source code for all animations, can be accessed by becoming a patron. Link in the description. Thanks, and I hope to see you in the next video.